Welcome to Cinema Discussions. Today we are discussing Tunnel. My name is John, and I am joined by Vaughn.
Senior emergency rescue team correspondent.
Yeah, that's a good one. This one is another South Korean film, drama. And before we get into the film, let's go on with our recommendations for this one. It's going to be tough to find.
Might be a little tricky to find. This one was in pretty limited release.
Yeah, thankfully there
it,
are...
It came out like just 2 weeks ago.
Yeah, it's a lot of times, especially there's so many foreign films being played in the local theaters. I think because a lot of the American films aren't that good that are coming out right now.
I've noticed, being the beginning of September, we're in the little dead period between end of summer and fall movies.
Yeah, and I was looking at just looking at basic Rotten Tomatoes scores on the apps and. Mm. And seeing these movies come out that already the stories aren't interesting to me, and the tomato scores are super low. And then I see these Korean films that are out there, and the tomato scores are super high. Granted, they're not reviewed as much, so they can't be certified fresh.
Yeah, they don't have enough people yet.
But I'm like, I'm not going to waste my time in the American films right now. I'm gonna check out these Korean ones. Right. And I've been happy with doing that, at least.
It's nice that we have a bunch of new Korean followers.
Yeah, I think that's
thanks
good too.
To, if you're Train to Busan.
So yeah, definitely. If you're watching this in South Korea, I'm sure that it's going to be easier to find this movie. Although I don't know how long ago this already came out, but I definitely recommend this kind of movie. It's not as, I don't know. There's a lot going on, but there's not a lot going on in the film.
It is relatively straightforward.
Yeah,
pretty straightforward dramatic movie.
Yeah, it's not. It's a kind of true life kind of movie. I couldn't find anything saying that this is based on real events.
Yeah, I don't think it is.
But it's that kind of thing where it's plausible. Everything that happens in it is that. But it's got it's got good suspense in it, and good drama. Not overly I don't know, Hallmarky emotional.
No, it doesn't have the perfect happy ending. No.
Yeah, it doesn't do that stuff that a lot of the American versions of this kind of story do.
It's not all wrapped up by the end of the movie.
Yeah, or even just like throughout it, they're not playing like they work with family drama in there, but not to these kind of saccharine way that they do it in some of the American films. I think this is just a well done way of doing it. So I think when I went to see the movie in theaters, when I bought the ticket, they said, "Just so you know, this movie isn't in English. Is that gonna be okay? Is that are there subtitles?" Yes, I don't see what the problem is here.
Yeah.
So there was a warning for me. So if you are adverse to reading subtitles, it might be tough. But I think you can still get most of the. You can still enjoy a lot of the movie without reading the subtitles. There's good stuff in there, but I think the best stuff is comes out, and a lot of the dialogue is really good.
You miss a lot of the nuance to it.
Yeah. Anything anyone you wouldn't recommend this one to? Or?
No reason not to give it a shot if you have some free time.
Yeah, I think this is a film that can work for most anyone. This is
it's a good segue to fall movies.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah. So now let's get into this spoiler alert of the film. The film's called The Tunnel, and that's about all I knew going into the movie. And I especially like that about foreign films that we mentioned on Train to Busan, because I hadn't seen any trailers for it, so. All I know is the title, and it's a very limited thing. And whereas some titles, like The Assassination of Jesse James by the Coward Robert Ford, like that pretty much, all right, I'm pretty sure that this dude's going to kill that dude.
I think I could tell what's going to happen
at some point.
Eventually.
But, Titanic, Lincoln, one of those things. Some people were surprised by what happens in Titanic, even though it's called Titanic. But that's like a history thing on that. So, yeah, if you don't know that. So this one's called The Tunnel, and... We start out with our hero in his car, and after he fills up on his gas and gets his two water bottles as a apology for filling up too much gas, he's talking on the phone and talking about, oh, this tunnel coming up, and I'm going to be going into this tunnel, and you're like, all right, something's going to happen in this tunnel.
This is the tunnel.
So I knew something was going to go on the tunnel, and another thing too is I don't know going into it if this is going to be a horror film, sci-fi kind of film. If you know, aliens at some point are going to come into this,
like a thriller.
Yeah, you know, I don't know what to expect with this movie. Like, but I knew something's going to happen with this tunnel, and they don't waste much time as getting into that. He gets into the tunnel, goes a little ways, starts to quake, and then
you don't get 45 minutes of exposition like a Tarantino.
Exactly.
Yeah.
But then instantly. Trapped in this tunnel, or it collapses on him, and we then get to see him that he's survived, and trapped in his car, and that leads to the rest of the film. It's you know, it immediately reminds me of 127 Hours.
The climbing movie.
Yeah, because you're following one guy. Trapped under a rock, trapped in one place, in a confined space for a long amount of time, and has to figure out how to survive with the resources that you've got around you, in a reachable distance, and hoping that someone will come to rescue you, because you're at a point where you can't really do anything for yourself.
With that in mind, this is one of the few movies where the guy's cell phone survives the initial calamity.
Yes, and
it's a major part of the movie.
Yeah, and there's so many things like that that happen that is why I question if it was based on a real story, certainly inspired by, you know, the true story of 127 Hours, the Chilean miners,
other people who get, you know, are. They said some people are trapped in a grocery store or something.
Yeah,
something.
Yeah. There's so many instances of people being trapped in situations like this, especially in mining accidents, or, you know, someone stuck down a well, so that there's a lot to draw off of in this. You don't need to have it be based on something real, but it's just, you know, how that happened with there. But so the ability that he does have his cell phone, and it at first he gets no service, and then. Finally, something comes through.
Yeah.
It doesn't take too long, but gets through so that he's able to make the emergency call. And I loved that. It was in my, you know, cheering for the hero in this. And when he's able to make that call, I was so happy, because it's like, all right, they know where he is. They know roughly where he is. They know that he's in a tunnel. And even though the call dropped out when he was still talking with them. He was able to get the information to them, and that's just the minimal thing that you need so that you can have hope for the rest of your survival. If he had had no other contact with anyone else after that point, putting myself in that situation, I am less likely to lose hope because I've gotten that call out there. And if you hadn't gotten call out. So much easier just to give up.
Yeah, chance of survival drops to like single digits.
Yeah, they're just gonna forget about you.
Yeah,
which is kind of, we get some of that. We get to see the other character who is really in that 127 hours moment of being pinned against a rock, isn't able to call for help, and so all the time until that, I can't remember how many. Days it was. I think it was on the third day. It was 2 hours and 2 days and 7 hours into it, is what he tells her. If I'm remembering the subtitles correctly.
At the one point, he suddenly knows that all of a sudden there's this little dog in the rubble with him.
So like the dog,
like, oh shit.
The dog's either coming from the outside, which there's a way out, or it's coming from another car.
He was already in here.
Yeah. So
that's when he hears a woman calling out. Who's in a nearby car.
You get that moment with the fan blades, and he kicks out the first one, and then the weight of the other fan blades circles us back down, and like it's coming to the point where like this is gonna be a decapitation scene, because he lifts it up and puts his head through, and it comes down, but just, you know, hits him a little bit. The force isn't great enough
Yeah, it's just coming down by gravity. It's but not it's that thing
where if this was
anymore.
A Final Destination movie, where like he survived death so far, and then Clear takes his head off. Mm-mm. Again, not knowing what kind of movie this is.
Yeah.
Don't know what to expect at that moment. But thankfully not killing off your protagonist.
Yeah. They wasn't that far into the movie.
No.
It wouldn't work if they'd done it then.
No. Well, you would have then had to switch protagonist to the other character and you know.
It's like, oh, well, that's the end of that.
Mm-hmm.
Let's go
it
to
becomes
our next
an
person.
Anthology story. And just move on to the next person.
Yeah.
So you get to meet her, and from the first moment that you see the chair with the rebar poking into the chair.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, from the back.
Yes, poking it from the back, and from the first moment I saw that, I think she's impaled.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's, with everything coming at her from all these directions, it is unlikely that she's not. She's complaining about her side hurting. This doesn't look good for her, and yet he has to make these decisions of sharing his water with her, because he's rationed it out from what they've told him to save, and he looks like the way he was drawing on the bottle,
mm-hmm.
that he was even being more economical with his water than they were already saying. He was saying that they have to, you know, make this last for 7 days,
yeah.
And it looked like he was even making the one bottle.
Yeah, it looked like I couldn't tell from the handwriting. He either rationed it out in like 4 hour blocks,
mm-hmm.
or four parts to 1 day. I wasn't really sure from the handwriting. But
it seemed like
partial bottle last a pretty long time.
Yeah. It seemed like he was being very conservative with his water, mm-hmm. Which is smart on his part for allowing us to stay down there. I think that's a thing to think about if you get stuck in these situations and the rescuers are telling you X amount of days. It's kind of like with construction on your house. You're like, all right, let's double that.
Yeah.
ration for that. See if I can survive that long. But he sees that she's, you know, I think he's one concerned for his own survival, and also you have to think of how likely is it that she's going to survive this. But he's a good guy and shares his water with her, albeit, you know, not telling her the full extent of how much water he has or about the cake, but still giving her some water and even giving the dog some water. And I'm unsure about how much he gave her, because he gave the dog water behind the chair. So it's the thing of like, yeah, totally doing this.
Yeah.
not really giving that much. And even though that she does die, so his all that water that he's given is, useless in saving her. But that's a thing where you don't know in that moment if she's going to die, if the rescuers are going to come.
She was essentially pinned into her chair by this slab of ceiling. And so he had no way of seeing that she was impaled through the stomach.
He's able, in his anger after she is dead, he's able to move the rock that's pinning her. And then see her wound impalement.
Unfortunately, she was dead already.
Yeah,
she just didn't know it.
Yeah, and it's the kind of thing where the pinning, her being pinned could possibly be preventing the blood loss that could happen.
The
impalement would already.
The rebar itself is like plugging her wound.
Yeah,
it's like you don't see any of it from behind. So it's just a partial impaling.
Yeah, but
you would die from either blood loss or infection at that point.
It's that thing that you don't know, though, too, of depending on how long that they're able to get there to rescue them. If he had moved her from that, and there's more they could have risked by moving her,
mm-hmm.
So it could potentially, if he had moved that before, and then they had, you know, come just in the wrong time after that, just enough time afterwards that she could have died. So it probably was best that he couldn't move.
Yeah, as far as I know, like from
if he doesn't have the tools.
Minimal medical knowledge. Like generally, if somebody's stuck on something or impaled by something, you want to leave it in so it's plugged.
Yeah, it depends on the circumstances that you are. There's extreme cases if you are in a place where no one can get to you. But you can then you kind of have to gamble with it.
It's a race against the clock.
Yeah, you take it out, plug it up, and get the hell away from to some place where you can be safe. But otherwise, you would want to like cut the rebar on the back of it, move it to a medical facility where they can actually take care of it.
Yeah.
Yes. So, but he does, as the news reported said, that he didn't lose his humanity in that moment when he's stuck in there. Mm-hmm. And that was another kind of thing where it, you know, I'm thinking of this is maybe a little Hallmarky, to use the expression for that, of the best case scenario of characters.
The reporters are like, we're all very, like, a little bit obnoxiously cheerful about all of it.
They're trying to make the best news story out of anything. And you get the one reporter where when he's about to be rescued, just shy of the record of how long he was there. Mm-hmm. And the guy's like, one more day and it would have been, the world record. And the leader of the evacuation team is like, you think we should just leave him in there for an extra day? You're horrible. You're just trying to sell news stories.
Yeah.
And I'm trying to save a guy.
Yeah, which was a recurring motif in the whole movie. It's sort of this indictment of the media industry in Korea.
It's them and the corporation that's building the other expressway.
Yeah.
And to try to get more people to go be able to do commerce in this other area. So
they're making these two tunnels through the mountains.
Yeah.
Like, to get a new new freeway between Seoul and Hado. New Hado, something like that.
We'll be corrected.
Yeah. this tunnel collapses while they're in the process of making the second one.
Yeah. So they can't do the explosions, the detonations for the other tunnel because it could risk trapping him even more.
Yeah.
Or killing him. Potentially any number of things. So they've halted the construction on that for so long. Mm-hmm. And they're losing so much money. So you've got the rescue team, who is very dedicated on rescuing him, and his wife. He's very dedicated on that. You've got the government, who's got to placate all the different sides of things with business and saving. Although
for the government officials, it was mostly about just keeping up appearances.
Yeah,
they were hamming up everything for the reporters,
and they don't want to be the ones to kill someone. They also don't want to be the ones to lose so much money in commerce for that, to waste so much money and resources on saving someone that turns out to be dead.
Yeah.
Because if they get there and he's a corpse, that's not going to be a good news story for them.
Mm-hmm.
or at least the way they see it. And there would definitely be some people who will look at that and say, well, at least they made the effort, you know, and applaud them for that. But even like them doing the math on the outside of it and thinking how long someone can survive without water, without food, knowing how they know the resource that he's had, and they know that they've told him to ration it for 7 days. So especially after the first time when they're unable to get him, and it becomes, you know, 40 days being in there.
Like 35.
30, yeah.
35 when he gets out.
But, and it had been in that amount of time, and to know that he doesn't have, they've lost communication with him. As far as they know, he doesn't have any more water and no more food.
Mm-hmm.
So you're looking at how long he's surviving without any rations, and just looking at it on a standpoint of how long basic human survival is, there's no way that he's alive. The odds are definitely against him in that, so you might as well give up. And especially I think after the death of the one guy during the working to save him,
one of the foremen,
because then you're bringing in, we're losing other lives to save one life.
Mm-hmm.
and while the foreman is, you know, he couldn't speak for himself because he was the guy who was definitely in there to save this guy, regardless of what it's costing, and you know, to an extent. But it's the other people who see it now that now they're able to voice this as his death.
Everybody else was getting upset about the tunnel foreman dying.
Yeah,
it was just a freak accident.
Yeah.
Okay.
so yeah, it could have happened on any job site. Yeah. But this now is associated with.
But then there's a follow up scene where the mother of that foreman.
Yeah, and she's finds throwing the eggs.
The wife of our guy, and she is now blaming them personally for this.
Yeah, but you get a good compassion moment in there, because she's throwing the eggs at his wife, and his wife just takes it, lets her do that, and then once she's out of energy, goes and hugs her and consoles her.
Well, that's a weird thing I see in a lot of Asian movies. It's a grief and anger that's being misdirected at the wrong people or thing.
Yeah, I've seen that in American movies too, and I think it's a common human thing. You're blaming them, but they're both rational enough that they know that deep down they understand that it's not her fault, it's not his fault. I think they understand that deep down too, because if she didn't understand that when his wife goes over to console the woman, the woman would have fought her off and said no attacked her at that moment. Does understand that they are both at a point where one has lost her husband, the other one has potentially lost her husband, is trying to save him. And I think she's trying to, she's is able to understand it from the trap man's wife's point of view, of wanting to get her husband back, and definitely feeling terrible for this death that the rescue effort has caused. So they both feel bad about the situation, can understand on a level what these people have risked and that it was for a good cause. I enjoyed that moment of humanity and that point as well. But then they eventually give up on him, and not before the rescuer is trying to make a last effort to see if he's there.
The emergency response director.
Another thing that was interesting right before that moment was shortly before that, after he's lost communication, he starts to work to dig his way out.
It kind of takes him a long time to realize that there's that big oak gap next to the passenger door.
And that's something that he gets to be able to stretch outside. But after that, he's able to find some dripping water, possibly coming down from the snow melting.
It was raining hard for several days, and it took like 3 or 4 days for it to eventually.
Yeah, first rained hard, and then the snow eventually got over the pass too. Mm-hmm. So there's a lot of moisture coming through that. Can drip down, it just takes forever.
Taste very good either,
but right before he's about to drink his own pee,
yeah,
and so that saves him from that, and you get the comical moment of the other guy trying it. So I've only there was a time at Knott's Halloween Haunt, they have the trapped maze,
like 2 years ago or something.
Yeah. And in one of their trap mazes, they had a place where you're supposed to drink what they say is urine, but it's like vinegar and something mixed in there. And that alone was so horrible. So like what they were showing as synthetic urine, at least, was so terrible.
Yeah, vinegar and apple juice.
That's all what I can imagine for for drinking urine. So like that's the thought, the taste I have in my mind. Like, no, bad. But then I'm also thinking, like, there's no way it can be that bad. It's got to be better than that, which is already terrible. But it's the thing of, if you have nothing, no other option. The other thing I was thinking of too is, you know, if you're well hydrated, and you're drinking nothing but water and a ton of water, and you drink that urine, it's going to be mostly water in the urine.
I think it'll be at least 98% water or something.
And the urea, I believe it's called from my high school biology days, all the waste material and anything of that, is going to be
it's mostly
minimal.
It's mostly protein, like maybe a little bit of minerals.
Yeah.
Maybe some like cellular waste.
Yeah, but, and it's yeah. and so, but when he's so dehydrated, it's mostly the waste yeah, materials.
Yeah.
And so in the thought experiment things, when they're talking about, you know, like Bear Grylls doing the drinking urine, Bear Grylls drinking his own urine is drinking it while he's well hydrated.
Mm-hmm.
And doing it in the safety environment of, oh yes, theoretically, if I had to do this in a survival place, and so many of the thought experiments about how you can drink your own urine are, I believe, are done in a place where someone is well hydrated, mm-hmm. and not done when someone is horribly dehydrated.
It's not done like 10 days into survival.
Yeah, so I'm wondering how much actual hydration can he actually get?
Not much.
It's not... Like, so that's what I started questioning in that moment is, you know, you're prolonging yourself maybe another day. Like, this isn't really going to help the way that the littlest bit of water is going to help.
Even the guy says that urine is sterile, generally.
Yes.
Under ideal conditions.
Yeah.
And like, if you're ill for a long time, then that'll start getting flushed out in the urine. But yeah, under less than ideal circumstances, then it starts to go down very quickly.
Yeah, so I think that it's the kind of thing where unfortunately, he doesn't have the bottle, an empty bottle in the beginning.
Mm-hmm.
But it's the, if you're trapped in the situation, then I think your ideal situation is if you had like a cup or something.
If you could save it from like the beginning.
Yeah, save your first day's urine.
That'll be slightly more ideal, yeah.
Yeah, and then then drink your water. And then you get to that, like have different grades. Because if you start saving your urine when you're already dehydrated, that's going to be a problem.
Fair. Anyway.
So, but my other thought was how long into the trapping that he started trying to dig towards one of the sides of the tunnel, or in that case, this the area where they were digging down.
Mm-hmm.
My thought on that is, as soon as he's able to get out of the car, I don't know, I probably would have tried to get out of the car much sooner than that. Like, how many days into being trapped is it going to take for you to start digging one way or the other?
Mm.
Or would you not do it in the risk that there could be further collapse on top of you?
He did play it safe because after the initial collapse, every time he moved around, more of the stuff settled.
Yeah. And
even days into it, that's still going to be a risk.
Yeah. Well, I'd definitely play it safe for maybe 2 days.
Mm-hmm.
On this, he's got the cake, he's got the water, so he has some resources. But you know, if I've gone through one of the water bottles, I'm halfway through my supplies. I know I'm going to need energy to mm-hmm. dig out if I'm going to be digging out.
Mm-hmm.
And the thought is, he's in communication with them and knows that it's going to take them, mm-hmm. you know, 7 days, hopefully, to save you. But you know. My thought would be at that point, at least hopefully, I would think that my thought would be at that point is to play it safe and try to dig one of the ways out. Because at a certain, I'm not sure how long I've been able to live in there.
Mm-hmm.
You know, even again, thinking of the movie 127 Hours, that's doing our math here, 72 is 3 days, and it's a... You know, like six days.
Like 5 days.
Yeah.
A little more.
So that's how long that dude waited until he cut his arm off.
Mm-hmm.
Spoiling a true life event in this review. But, that's how long he waited for that point. And I'm thinking about that, and you're saying 7 days is how long I have to go. And that's longer than that. And the under... general circumstances in averages, the rule of threes, where a human can go 3 weeks without food, 3 days without water.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, that can be definitely changed, but that's the averages that you're thinking of.
Yeah.
So if I'm thinking, all right, you can go, I'm good with the case gonna, you know, go away, but I can still survive without that. I'm gonna be weaker, but I can do that. I have 2 bottles of water. They say it's gonna be 7 days. I can go 3 days without water. This is gonna be tough. Mm-hmm. At that point alone, so I'm gonna want to try to work some way. And if you know, I would, if I'm in communication with someone else, then it's the thought of, all right, which way is shorter? Mm-hmm. Where am I based on what you've triangulated for where you think I am in this tunnel? Should I dig this way or that way? And start digging from one point. And I'm sure they would advise against it and be like, no, you're gonna cause more collapse. But I gotta get out of here. I gotta try something. And had he started that effort beforehand, he likely could have been rescued earlier if he had already started digging one of the ways. But it's the thing of you don't know how much you can trust these people on the other end. They want to keep your hope alive, so they're not gonna tell you, I don't think we're gonna. And it's, you know, we want to get there in a week, but yeah, it's probably gonna take like 2 weeks or so. And you know, there's also a holiday weekend coming up, so yeah, okay, you know, we're kind of pretty tired right now, and there's some new Netflix show just came out, so yeah, it's realistically it's gonna take us a little longer than that. You know, if money was no object, of course, you know, yeah, we could do it this way. So that kind of thing, like, you don't know.
Yeah. I don't know why they didn't get the company to foot the bill for a lot.
Oh, they absolutely should.
Yeah.
And when the investigation goes on to say that it was shoddy construction, I'm sure they're being sued.
That's like 2 weeks into the rescue.
Yeah, they're definitely, that company's definitely being sued by the government for the, at least, the cost of getting them out. That is a bare minimum, that especially in America, that's going to happen with there. I like the, going back to the beginning of the film when the, rescue worker, is shouting at the reporter who calls him, the first reporter to get through to him.
The first one to call, yeah.
Yeah, and he's shouting at him like that his battery's gonna die, and saying, you know, under the ethics law of television,
the media ethics law.
Yeah, that he's quoting to him. So at first, when he's quoting that to him, I was thinking, wow, you know, I don't know a lot about South Korean laws and any of that stuff. I know next to absolutely nothing. I would say pretty much nothing is what I know about South Korean laws. I know one thing about South Korean laws, and that's only from my point of view, is that they're better than North Korean laws. That's about it. So when I saw
if you know, write us an email. Yeah.
So when I know I think we know from the movie Gone Next alone. Like, so I'm thinking about that. I'm like, oh, that's an interesting ethics law. And I know that America has lots of ethics in journalism laws that are out there for different ways, and not
they're
necessarily
more like guidelines.
Well, they don't come into play all that much, but there are. I know that in Europe they have strict anti-paparazzi laws, mm-hmm. That were put into place after Princess Diana. Mm-hmm. So they are much stricter on the paparazzi than they are here in America. Because of freedom of press, we have so much, like, you know, just going off of the First Amendment and the Constitution, America has so much protection towards that stuff. But there are places where you have to step in and say, you know, when you're putting someone in danger, that's a different thing. I know that there's different degrees. It wasn't out of the realm of possibility that they have these laws in place for that. So I was like, oh, that's an interesting law. Nice to know that fact. And then when he says, nah, I just made that up.
Yeah, I just made that up. Like, clearly, they didn't know either.
Yeah. And that's a beautiful thing about quoting obscure laws to people. Quote the right number, you know, put in enough details in there.
Be really specific about it.
Be very specific.
Usually it makes it sell better.
Yeah, and, you know, there's so many obscure laws that you could quote something weird, and if it's not too outlandish, people are going to believe you on that. And they're going to be like, well, I don't want to be fined by that. And so I'm not gonna violate that, of course.
In our case, we have so many regulations that get put on the book because they require less scrutiny to go in,
and especially
most of the time government agencies can put them in as necessary.
Yeah, and you've got your city ordinances and then your state laws and then
like
federal laws.
Levels of it.
Yeah, so there's I have a book that has, you know, pages on the weird obscure laws about, you know, not being allowed to walk your chicken after a certain time, and
because something happened.
Something happened somewhere.
Something happened somewhere to... that this became such a really, really weird problem one time.
Yeah,
it's like, okay, we're gonna write a law on this because we can't, because of not double jeopardy, but the rule that you can't make a law and then prosecute somebody for doing it before you wrote the law.
Yes, so the law has to be in effect in the first place. So.
You can't retroactively prosecute somebody. Yeah, so because of that, they have to write the law then, and then it's there going forward.
Yep. So anyway, like that little moment in there. Easy to trick someone with that law. But it also for the safety of the guy. Like, he's got good reason for it.
Oh, yeah.
I think he's, there's so many good characters in this, I think. But most, the best ones are definitely our main protagonist, mm-hmm. and the main rescue worker, and our hero's wife, who are all just really good characters in that.
Mm-hmm.
Not that, you know, a lot of the other people aren't bad characters, just... You know, these people are shining examples of all the best things in there. And maybe our protagonist, he does share the water in that point. And it sounds like when he says, I'm going to bring the cake to her, he says to her, and it's thinking he probably means his daughter. Like, I'm going to get this out and bring it to her. Or does he mean I'm going to bring this to the woman in the other car to share the food with her? Because I was thinking that is possibly what he was meaning in that sense.
You know, I'd have to see the syntax of that again.
Yeah, there's so much context before to know, but there's potential that could have meant he was going to share the cake with the other woman. But right after that happens, he falls asleep and the dog eats all the cake.
Yeah.
So even though the cake is going bad.
Speaking of the dog.
Yes.
Yeah. I thought that. For sure, by the time he got to like 30 to 35 days,
mm-hmm.
he would have tried to eat the dog.
Yeah, that was a...
not that it's an Asian joke.
It's a survival thing. But
yeah. I thought for sure he would have tried to.
Potentially. Again, the thing with being able to go 3 weeks without food, he's had the cake, he's had some food.
He did find the dog food.
He found the dog food eventually, and I think if he hadn't found the dog food, maybe it could have gone in a different direction.
That would have been a very bad day.
Yeah, but but finding the dog food definitely helped with that. I think water's his main concern there,
mm-hmm.
Before food, and he seemed to be a rational enough person, and especially with the story of, you know, his daughter wanting a dog,
mm-hmm.
Once it's over the radio that the dog is there, and his daughter wants a dog, if he comes out and there's no dog, or worse, a dog skeleton, or partially eaten dog carcass, it's really not going to look good. So yeah, it's something that it's there that is a potential that could happen. I mean, Donner Party situation. You need to whatever you need to eat at a certain point. Become survival of the fittest, and that's what happens. But as if you can hold out for long enough, when your humanity is intact, you want that to stay there. Very good that didn't happen. There are so many things they put into place, like, you know, they gave him the water bottles and the thing. If he hadn't have filled up the more water, that he would have been on the other side of the tunnel. If they hadn't filled up that much gas, it would have been able to set a tunnel before the collapse.
I don't know how much farther he would have gotten in 20 seconds.
They filled up three times as much because it was supposed to be $30 worth. They put in $90 worth.
Yeah.
That's three times as much gas. That means it took them three times as long to fill that.
Okay.
And just knowing how long it takes to fill up a tank of gas anyway,
mm-hmm.
I think he would have been on the other side of the tunnel by that time. Had nothing else prevented him, something else come in the way, there could have been a number of circumstances, but then again, the other woman would have still been in there. We mm-hmm. still would have had this story. It just wouldn't have been this person mm-hmm. in that predicament at that time. But he comments on it at one point of had that not happened, if it wouldn't have been for that, he wouldn't have been there.
It would still be from his perspective. He's now watching it all on TV.
It would have been a boring movie of just watching
me.
But that moment, like, if you're in those situations, it's the kind of thing where you see that on TV, like, oh shit, that's terrible. What else is on? And like, you might check in with it because, like, fascinated with it, like any national news story. Yeah, just not gonna be. You're not putting as much attention into it as if it's someone that you know that's in that situation.
Yeah.
It would have been because, like, his wife, when she first finds out, like, there was a collapse in this area, and she's like, "That's close to me," and so she's a little worried. And then there's a man, and like everything starts getting closer. Like, oh no. And then say the name. And
that's kind of like that moment where, like, you're following behind a fire truck. It's sort of in your neighborhood.
When you're driving home, home, and the fire truck's, like, going the same, making all the same turns, like, uh-oh.
Uh-oh. Don't turn left.
And then they're...
Shit.
Yeah. No, I've had that happen a couple times. It's getting so close. You're like, where are you going?
Oh, God.
But again, it's the same thing. It turns off just before, and you're like, oh, that was close. And then you keep going. Like, that's the end of your following that story, especially if you don't see a building on fire.
Yeah.
You're like, oh, it's no one I know. And then you move on. Because these things happen so often. Like, you can't be preoccupied every time something happens. This story got so much media coverage that, of course, they would know about it. It's just they wouldn't be so invested with it.
Yeah.
And you, builds all up to the great moment after he's saved. And like, what is he saying? I love that so much. As the commissioner, what is she, the politician?
Oh, the lady, a department.
Yeah, minister. And she's the minister. Yeah. And she's going up to him and getting ready and... God, these people are fuck away from me. get these assholes.
Like, fuck off, all you assholes.
Yeah, something. Yeah. Okay.
She has to stop. Like,
yeah. Just walks her away. Like, it's like, me?
What?
Was
me?
I?
Who?
Me? Was he saying that about me? But that's just the best reaction. Just being like, you've been in this whole situation. They've got the cover over his eyes because he's been away from sunlight for so long.
Mm-hmm.
And they're just trying to get him to safety, and like, we can't take the helicopter off yet. We have to wait for her to show up.
Yeah, because right before he says that, it's like why is the helicopter not on?
Yeah,
and like, we're waiting for the minister to get here. And like, fucking A.
So the rescue worker, like, that's his sentiments.
Yeah, that's the straw that broke it. Broke the whole thing.
So part of you is wondering, and that is this what the guy actually said, or is this what the rescue worker is saying? But I think
ultimately it doesn't matter.
Yeah, it doesn't. It's the same. It works regardless. And then you get the thumb up.
Yeah.
Okay. But then I like the way the media turns it around.
Yeah.
And it's just like, gives the thumbs up to everyone. Thanks for all the support. Like, they just don't cover what he said. Aside from whatever live feed, I'm sure they cut it out, whatever. And so that's only known to the people around there. But the apology that the rescue worker has to sign, I was told to quote him exactly. So in that moment, I'm like, okay, that's what the guy actually said. It works for there.
They asked me what he said.
Yeah. So I think there's so many good moments with like that in there. So overall, love this movie. This is good fun. What would you rate this film? The movie's running time is 127 minutes. Fun coincidence for 127 hours.
Uh-huh. Yeah, a little bit long for a suspenseful movie.
Yeah.
Generally, they you know, like a lot of horror movies, if you keep the pace fast...
Yeah, you generally keep a 90-minute runtime on those. But it didn't seem to draw out too long. It had so many moments where it could have, and you've got someone trapped in an mm-hmm. area. They kept it flowing and kept developments happening. I think it was very entertaining with that. I think it lacks a little bit of in-depth thrilleriness or twists or. Mm-hmm. Some surprise factor in there that they don't really have that would be in some kind of a David Fincher kind of movie. Mm-hmm. It's the only thing that it could be more, I could say, and that's the only thing that prevents me from giving it like a 5 stars. But otherwise, this is a 4-star film for me. I think this is a great example of how to do a movie about someone trapped. I think it was very well done with that. The only other things that I think they could have done maybe are when you choose a point in the film where you no longer follow either the rescue workers or no longer follow the person who's trapped, so that you don't know what's going to happen when they get to him, or when he gets to somewhere. Like, if you stop following the rescue workers and you just follow him, then it's him going, struggling through and seeing how far you can get, and you don't know, because he doesn't, like, when communication's cut off, he doesn't know what point they're at or if they've given up on him. So you could stop following the outside world at that point. Or if you stop following him when communication's cut off, you're going to rescue him, you go there, and you don't know whether he's going to be alive or dead when you get to him. It's okay. That little bit of suspense that's in there. Quick little spoiler alert for Saw 2. Mm-hmm. There's a thing they do with time in that movie where you're following the guy. They're trying to save a guy, the one guy before time runs out, or trying to get to the room before a certain amount of time. They're watching this live feed of what's going on when they find the live feed of what's going on in the room. And so, spoiler alert for that in this quick moment, it's a pre-recorded thing. And when they get to the room, everyone's dead, and this is already
happened. That this resolved itself days ago.
Yes.
Yeah.
So it's that kind of thing where you could have, they could have done that in this incident. If this would have been a different kind of film, if this would have taken that horror turn, having a bad ending to the film, where once you cut off communication, they're digging for him, you see him trying to escape out, and you're showing both sides of things, and then they reach the point where he has dug to, and you think it's at the same time, but then they open it and you find a corpse there, and then you flash to show the timing that it took, and it actually took them much longer than it did with him, and you realize that the time difference has been out there. And so if this were a horror film, that's how you end it in that way. But because this is a drama and an uplifting drama, you know, about being able to survive and the goodness of humanity, because it has that happy ending in it, you don't do that. But if you did have an option where he died, I would do that one, because then that gets you that little twist moment where you're like, oh man, I thought it was the thing, and then it was
time. Non-linear time is sadly underutilized by a lot of people.
Very much. I think it's that's why I love so much that it was used in that one film. And so, but
almost the whole franchise.
Yeah, it's a thing that really just doesn't get utilized enough. So that's the thing where if that had happened in this film, this would be 5 stars. So not that it needed to happen in this
idea.
Yeah, not that that needed to happen in this film. This film perfectly works as it is, and 4 stars for me is a essentially a perfect score for a movie. It's that 5th star that's that little something extra that it takes, and so that's what would have gotten me the 5th star for this film. Mm-hmm. So how would you rate this one?
I think I rated Train to Busan 4.5.
I think so.
I would call this a probably a 4.
Yeah.
It didn't have as much to really suck you in.
Yeah, and I think that's the thing of Train to Busan. That's a written film. It's a fictional scenario entirely, and that's why going back to where questioning whether or not this was based on true events. It's those little extra moments that it seems like it's only sweetened enough. It's only changed enough to make it real life into fictional for a film, dramatized version. But there's not so much that's outlandish that it seems like they've added these elements to raise just purely to raise the stakes. It seems like any of these things could have happened there, and I think that's something that not necessarily hurts the film, because it makes it such a good thing. It's just it's that thing that Train to Busan and films like that can have those extra elements that they can push those questions and make you think about things a lot more. Good solid film.
Yeah, really solid.
Yeah. Well, thank you for watching this one with us. I know it's a bit of a long discussion on this one, but thanks for joining us on this journey. And if you've got any comments about anything that we've said on here, or any further insight, please let us know in the comments below or write to us at magicapetv@gmail.com. You can always find our podcast on iTunes or Stitcher, anything like that. Also, check out Instant Discussions. Still doing that one every week. And that one's just on podcast. That's where we talk about movies that are on Netflix streaming. So you can watch those ones at home and then discuss with us on there. And of course, if you're listening to the podcast, you can find us on YouTube, magicapetv.com. Thank you for watching.